talk, the first speaker of the day is Ursula Minstad, and she's going to talk about the aquatic properties of strata with silica.
First of all, let me thank you for inviting me here to this very nice conference. I have to say a few words why I did this talk today. This talk, and it has to do with what we learned yesterday about my elements of Dali. Probably every one of you has afternoon talks reporting on your work. It makes me feel very humble listening to what you did. And also, I'm probably one of those of you who have known her the longest. I got to know her in 2002, and she was still a grad student. And I have been meeting her regularly ever since, and I try to find, use a topic or one of my topics, but maybe not my most profound work, but it's closest to what she did. And there's another reason. Namely, 1 week before Mariam died, Marina Ratner died. And I do think that this fact has not been properly noticed by the community. And I also like to somehow celebrate the work of Marina Ratner at the same time. So what I do today is rather give a picture, and at the end you will have a new result. But I will not really tell you the peculiarities that go into the proof, but rather tell you what's probably going on. And that very nicely, I think, the picture is very nice, and I hope you appreciate it. So that maybe not, so I also should apologize, only some of you will not learn much or nothing at all in my talk, but anyway. So let me start with homogeneous dynamics. So I start with Marina Ratner, who is the older one. With the following situation. So G is, as usual, always variable in 2. This is my standing hypothesis. So I look at the group sp2gr, and there is a lattice. sp2gz is a lattice in sp2gr. So now we can take the quotient. My quotient will be from the left to. And I can have them, so I took at the quotient. And now as left and right actions on a regroup commute, obviously, we can take a right quotient, or try to take a right quotient by some other subgroup of sp2gr. And the group that I want to take is a group sp2g minus 2g minus 2r. So what this is a group of all matrices of the following form. So I have 1, 1 on top, and then comes a symplectic matrix size 2g minus 2 squared. So this is a naturally subgroup of sp. Now if we have this group acting from the right on this space, then we can ask ourselves a question like, what about ergodic properties? The group sp2gr carries a harm measure which is right and left invariant. So the harm measure descends to this function, and since it's by left invariant, but since it's also right invariant, it's invariant under the right action of the group sp2g minus 2r. So now here's Moore's theorem. This is a very old classical theorem which says that the right action. The right action of SP.
It's your t-shirt.
Oh, I didn't bring the t-shirt.
SP2G to R on this quotient space that we might be smaller, but since you have seen it before. To save some space. This is ergodic. And this is the same as saying that if you take the quotient of the group sp2gr from the right by the group sp2g minus 2r, the left action of sp2gz on this quotient space is ergodic for the harmonic.
the work of Marina Wagner kicks in, and what she proved is a following, you know, that you can say much, 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 much more. And if we knew this any SP 2T minus 2 are a very measure on, let me call this space here M for the moment, to save some space on M, then there exists a V group, which is a supergroup of SP 2D minus 2R. It's a V subgroup. Here in this context, a V subgroup is nothing else but a closed subgroup of the group SP 2D minus 2R. And such that, and a point x and m, such that on the orbit of sp of L, sorry, intersected with sp 2g z is a lattice, and the mu is half on the quotient. Section lambda, so mu is far on lambda not r. So in other words, if you have a measure, an invariant measure, which is not the standard Haar measure on this quotient space, then you can find a somehow smaller quotient space that looks exactly the same, where the lattice here happens to be the intersection of sp2gc with some lattice in L, but somehow the situation is exactly consistent with what we had before. And so that theorem tells you that this is the only thing that you can have. And every orbit closure, this is the orbit closure theorem, every orbit closure is of this form. So if you take any orbit of the sp2g minus 2r action on this space and take its closure, then all the closures look like this. And either the entire space or it's, so we have this supergroup here. Of course, the supergroup could just be sp 2g minus 2r. All right. So what is an example? So the first example is that L is equal to sp 2r plus sp 2g minus 2r. This can happen, and so this is obviously a supergroup of sp 2g minus 2r, and they have two types of lattices. In the first case, it's at lambda. This lattice is irreducible. This means that it projects densely to both of the factors. Now, there's a theorem of Margulis in 91, which describes this situation. So what are irreducible lattices here? So Margulis says, if you have an irreducible lattice in a product of two Lie groups, then these Lie groups have been looked to be locally isomorphic, which means that in our case here, the G has to be 2. So Margulis says, in this case, so G is equal to 2, and furthermore, the arithmeticity theorem tells us lambda is equal to SR 2 or D. I mean, this is always up to finite index and these kind of things, where O D is an order in the real quadratic number. What this points down to is that the quotient space is the upper half plane plus the upper half plane divided out by this lattice. So this group SL2R plus SL2R acts on this product of the upper half planes, the quotient out by the maximal compact by SO
2 cross SO2, and then you see that you get an action here of on this lattice here on H basically the proportion of H2 cross SO2 by this lattice. This is called a, let me call this lambda, is a Hilbert modulus. So there's of course also the case that lambda is reducible, and then this is very easy. Then you, it's easy to see that it's basically the standard lattice in SVD, but it's a product of two lattices, so lambda is a product of two lattices. And so this is easy as well. And the second case is that L is not semi-simple. And then in this, I mean, I'm looking at a very specific case, then we know that L preserves a line in R2G minus 2G. So the group SP2GR acts obviously on R2G, so it's a group of symplectic transformations of the symplectic vector space R2, and it can preserve a line or may not preserve a line, but in this case, if you have a lattice here in L at all, in one of these supergroups, and the supergroup is not semi-simple, then the supergroup has to preserve it. All right. And so,
so lambda is the closure of the order intercept.
Sorry.
What is lambda?
This is a lattice. So this is a lattice in L. So it's intersection of my group, my Lie group L with SP2GC, and I'm assuming that it's a lattice. Because otherwise I don't get the orbit closures. That's what Ratner-Seum tells us. And I'm only interested in orbit closures in this talk. Now let's move on and go on to the Zieglerschmidt series. This is sometimes denoted to G. This is SP2G quotient R by U. So the unitary group. So the unitary group is the maximal compact subgroup of SP2GR. And how this arises, the way I like to think about it is SP2GR characterizes SP2GR. What UG is a space of complex structures on R2G which are compatible with the symplectic form. Compatible meaning that omega of J x J y is equal to omega of this one. That means compatible. And now naturally you get the complex interpretation, so this is a nice space. And so this, there's a flat S 2g minus 1 bundle, so this is now a sphere over dg, and this is equal to dg plus s 2g minus 1 quotient down by ut, sorry, this will not connect, sp2g quotient cross sphere quotient out by UG, where UG acts from the right in the standard way, and it acts from the left just as it would act on the unit sphere and the complex vector space of dimension G. And what is this space if you, can identify this? This is equal to SP2GR quotient out by UG minus 1. So the unitary group in acting on a complex vector space of dimension G minus 1. Now, as you can see here, the group SP2G minus 1, 2G minus 2R still acts from the right on this space because this is a subgroup of the group SP2G minus 2R. And now we can take the quotient, so what we get here is we get the following situation. SP2GR mod UG few next months. This is FETS Fear Bundle, and this projects to SP2G, our version R, but SP2G minus 2R. And what is this quotient space? This quotient space has a very nice interpretation that we call it omega. This is the space of all pairs x, y in C2G equals to R2G plus R2G such that omega of x, y is equal to omega. So if you think about it, now we come back to flat surfaces in a second. If you think about it, but this is exactly is a space of cohomology classes complex valued, which are positive. That means a pair that's the real and imaginary part, which is other is positive. It's exactly those cohomology classes that can potentially arise as cohomology classes defined by Euclidean differentials on the surface of G plus G. All right. So now let me come back to our flat. Flat structure, so we look at absolute information. So we take H, the moduli space of abelian differentials. On the surface, closed surface of GSD. And this is covered by a space that is that we call NG, which is, well, let me write down slightly different vector space. And this is a space of the Torelli space of marked homology marked. The being dimensions. So what you do is you take the titular space of marked being differentials and you function out by the Torelli group, then you get this space. And now we have a very nice commutative diagram for this NG quotients to H, which is this quotient by the left SP2GZ action. Now we move over by map psi to this bundle S.
Ursula, I'm missing your SP. And then you're quotienting out by
by the left action of SP2GZ. So you first quotient, the quotient Teichmuller space of marked abelian differentials by the Torelli group, and the Torelli group is of course normal, and then you can further quotient out the SP2GZ, and then you get the moduli space of abelian differentials. So we are working here, but we are really working here into this space. And now comes this beautiful diagram.
And what is the space on the right hand side?
This is my sphere bundle. Ah, okay. I hope. Thank you. This is my sphere bundle. Thank you. So this is my sphere bundle, which is this part. Let me write it down. This is SP, quotient R by U, minus 1. And here I'm measuring projection onto. Not yet. So I have a natural projection onto I should invite it to something different. I explain this in a second. Here I have a natural projection onto omega, and then I have a map from here to here, and let me try to explain what these maps are. So what is this? So F is an absolute period formation. I only say this in word, but that is so the leaf of the absolute period foliation consists of all differentials which have the same absolute period. That means they define the same absolute cohomology class with a complex coefficient. And now what is this map sign? So this NG is just a pullback of the bundle S under the Torelli map. So that's what it is. So here I'm flat bundle S over the circle upper half plane, upper half space. You pull this bundle back by the Torelli map, you get a bundle over Torelli space, which is a portion of Teichmuller space by Torelli group. So this is now a flat bundle over NG. Then you can look at this foliation. And so what is this diagram here means is that the SP2G minus 2 orbits on S are exactly pulled back exactly to the leaves of this foliation. So this is a very beautiful picture. This diagram is SP2GZ at Q-Dam. Meaning that on each of these spaces, the group SP2GZ acts from the left, and everything commutes with this action. I think this is a nice picture. And the question is, of course, if I can get an answer, but I think it's interesting, is here by Ratner's theorem for the absolute limit foliation. So what does this mean? There is no SP2G minus 2R action. So what is it supposed to be meaning by being a Ratner's theorem? It means that you have this foliation. And if you have a foliation, you can ask for transverse invariant measures. And the question is, can you completely classify transverse invariant measures, which if you translate it back, is exactly Ratner's theorem. And of course, the answer should be that you have a complete classification. So either you are Lebesgue, or you have some affine invariant manifolds, or whatever it was, some nice sort of some nice algebraic subspaces. That you have how on these subspaces in this configuration. So that's a picture that I like to call.
Now in H, do you take differentials of area 1 or not necessarily?
Yes, this is a H, I wrote it down already. So H was a space of, So H was supposed to be the space of abelian differentials, or I said it, but I didn't write it, area 1. Everything is aware of everybody. Thank you. So this comes from the sphere, right? If you take C, CG, then you get, of course, all, but I'm only interested in area 1. So that's a picture.
So can you just explain, if we're discussing strata, is this a picture, can you think it's a picture in the strata, or is this?
That's a global picture, and strata, I come back to this if I have time again. Strata, of course, much more complicated, because there you don't have four leaves of the absolute period foliation, right? I mean, so in the stratum, you make the absolute period foliation of lower dimension, so it's never any four leaf.
The principal strata is, or not?
Sorry?
Not even the principal strata?
Right, what did you ask me for?
Whether the leaves in the principal stratum are the same, are four dimensional, they are, right?
Yeah,
but
yes.
But is it the same equivalent question to ask for the...
You can ask this question on all levels, of course, and I would like to have an answer on all levels.
Okay.
But it, of course, is a sort of increasing level of difficulty.
Okay.
To, let me explain to you now what's known and what the difficulties are. All right. So let's look at an example. Where G is equal to 2. I mean, in genus 2, everything is known, but I mean, my point here is, first of all, I'm not sure anyone in this room knows everything about genus 2, but the second point is also that somehow the viewpoint I like to make here is maybe slightly different from what you sometimes see in discussion of blade surfaces. So what you know is, in this case, the map psi is essentially surjective. So you know exactly what you are missing. You miss those loci where we look at Torelli space, we look at this bundle over Torelli space, so we look at those which are Jacobian somehow, or also the point that are not Jacobian, and these correspond exactly to principally polarized linear varieties, which split as a product of two tor. So that's very well known. So we have this corresponds to points which split as products of two elliptic curves. So we are naturally in the closure of our the image of Torelli space. They are of lower co-dimension, and so that's so the co-dimension is non-trivial, so we have lower dimension. So everything is good. You can look at connectivity, and so this is very well understood. And now let's try to analyze what kind of orbit closures we can get in this situation. So we know orbit closures.
So when you write equal, is that the set that's missing?
Sorry?
The set that you wrote that tends to split, is that the...
So the point, I mean the point meaning a point in the model, in the space of principally polarized linear varieties. So you don't have a Jacobian anymore. So you have a complex torus which splits as a product of two elliptic curves. So this is in the target, it's not a Jacobian. But these are the only things that are missing. This is
right. So when you wrote equal to that missing stuff.
I'm sorry. Somehow my concentration doesn't seem to be super good today. So the set of points which split as product of two elliptic curves. And so the orbit closure is what is the orbit closures? Now we can look at the possibilities that we have for this Lie group and for the lattices. So when we know what the orbit closures on the right hand side are, so since orbits on the left hand side are open and we only add a few trivial things, so we can look at orbit closures on the left hand side as well. That means on the space of abelian differentials. And now what we get here is we have several cases. So we can have that the group L that I alluded to before is SP2GR plus SP2R. And the lattice lambda is irreducible. And then you get exactly what Kretman Mullen investigated, namely we get a lot of modular surfaces and abelian differentials that have two simple zeros of degree two, and so these are closed for the SL2R action as well. And of course, why they're closed for the SL2R action? Because this new group here contains a four on the left hand side, and it contains a four group SP2GR. And this is automatically SP2GR invariant. And this means that you get orbit closures with closed leaves here, so closure of leaves, but also nice. And the only thing that we can have is the modular surfaces that Kretman Mullen was describing in his work. So, and now what else can you have? So, if lambda is reducible, then you know that on the lattice SP. 4z intersects L, so SP2R in a lattice, and this corresponds exactly to the surface. Now I'm going back to the left hand side. If there's a surface, so this can happen. So if we have an abelian, so if it's a locus frame in the image of the map site, where it comes from an abelian differential, then the surface has a cover of the d, d bigger equal to 2 onto an elliptic curve. So we need square tight, so this is all what can happen. You cannot have cover of degree d equal to 1 because it doesn't have a number for to be a differential. And so that's all what you can have. So you have a complete picture, and now then, of course, there might be orbit, sort of orbits, possibly, leaves, leaf closures, sections, leaf separated sets. Which arise from non-semi-simple L, and that also happens. So what does this show as far as in GSV, the picture is exactly the same, except that these Hilbert modular circles do not show up anymore. Because of this irreducibility, the lattice here is irreducible, and as I showed you before, so this can only happen in, if the genus is a 2, so in higher genus this doesn't happen, but otherwise in genus 3 the picture is exactly the same. Now what's the conclusion? So for G equals 2 or 3, we have that absolute period formation. Psychotic for meson each. Measure. So what does this mean? So the Lebesgue measure, the natural power measure, that you see here, so on this cushion space, goes back to the Meson-Leach measure after the constant, of course, on our Torelli space, which then projects down to the Meson-Leach, projects down to the Meson-Leach measure on the modular space of linear differentials. And so we can ask what are the saturated sets, so this means that if A in H is a set separated for the formation, then the measure of H, that we call this measure lambda, is either 0 or is in, or lambda of H minus A is equal to 0. So you don't have non-trivial Borel sets which are saturated for this formation and which have, say, non-trivial measure up to measure 0, of course. So we also have, if U is the transverse, invariant measure for the variation, then either mu is equal to lambda, this corresponds to mu has full support. Or it's concentrated on closed supported on a closed subset of positive good dimension. Subset in the manifold or manifold or open for positive three dimension. So that's here. And so I don't write this down, so orbit closures that are also in vain under the SL2R actions are precisely those that arise from positive modular surfaces. Well, that's a picture. And of course, the end game will be, I mean, what, so the question is is the same picture too in any genes.
Well, what breaks down?
Sorry?
Why do you need to see the gene 2 and 3?
This is the next thing I have to talk about. So, what is going wrong in higher genes? So, the picture is exactly the same. So, we know, understand, so this is actually due to Hout, we understand perfectly this space omega. This space omega is wave friendly. And we know exactly what the image of this thing is. So it's everything besides those cohorted classes, which correspond to the following situation. You evaluate the cohorted class on the integral lattice of the surface, and then you see as an image a lattice in C, and this the corresponding map is of degree 1. This cannot arise. So if you have such a lattice, the corresponding degree has to be at least 2, because if you had degree 1, then it would mean that you have a holomorphic map of the surface onto the torus, and so this of degree 1, and this of course cannot happen, so every such map has to be of higher degree.
You said this was due to
sorry?
You mentioned a person that this would
this is actually due to Hout.
Could you write that down?
And this was rediscovered by Kapovich. Friendlies and Misha Kapovich. Discovered this. Now, what goes wrong? And so here's not that absolutely everything is beautiful on the side of omega in this map here, but what goes wrong is the following problem. You now look at the fibers of this map. Here the fibers are connected. But what are the fibers here? That's unclear. If the fibers here were connected, then you could immediately conclude that everything is beautiful. Simply because now the fibers correspond to fibers, exactly. And then you just pull, you know that every invariant measure pulls me. It introduces a measure that lives on the right-hand side, because I mean you have now a measure that lives here on the omega and you pull it up, and then you're good. But in general, we do not know whether these fibers are connected. Now there's a beautiful theorem by Cass Kalsamina, Pantavia, to sound, I guess, 15 or something like this, with S for G, bigger equal than 4, fibers. So I should compose 5 is 5. This diagram commutes is exactly this quotient here. In some sense, you can use it as this quotient because this is essentially the same space. Again, this map is injective and only leaves out a very few isolated points, so that's good. So now, good. For everything, and what I'd like to explain to you now is that these ideas can somehow be pushed using a slightly different viewpoint. So what you get as a corollary is the absolute period formation. Or the principle struggle. Turns out to be actually useful if you combine these two approaches in some way, you can go further and get better. So I haven't talked about Mann and Mazzucani's group yet, so where this is supposed to come in. So I haven't talked about orbit closures, orbit action, next because before we rediscovery of Kirkland Mullen, he made this precise, but I guess in Dark Weiss and Yaminsky's work, this was already there and in many other works before, so it's the idea of Schiffer variation. And the Schiffer variation, the name goes back to Schiffer, and is of course also from the early mid 1900s. And the idea is very simple. So the idea is how do you deform differentials? So what are your tools to do this? So how do you move in the absolute period formation? And let me explain to you what you do. So we take omega, period differential. Now what you can do is you can make a long slit on this. So both sides of the same length, say, you just cut the surface open along this segment, and then what you see is a picture that looks like this. You glue it back, but you collapse these sides and glue it back in this way. These guys have now become shorter. The other guys have become longer. So somehow you slide the zero backwards along the incoming incoming separators, there are seven connections. Then these become shorter. Was like this. Here you have your
on one of his cellular connections. And now these guys start shrinking, and then what you get is you get something different. At the end of the day, in finite time, you see a surface is a mark point, and this mark point is not going to be a pole, it's maybe a zero or maybe a regular point on these surfaces, and you see the Abelian differential on both sides, and the Abelian differential does not vanish in either. That's a very explicit degeneration. And now, where does the SR2R action comes from? So, first of all, we have a theorem, Eskin, and Zurich. Somehow, it's rather a sort of small part of their paper, but I mean, what it says is that the set of surface zone you obtain surfaces. There's no it's surface means modes are we always said you have an Abelian differential on the surfaces where both components have non-trivial area surfaces obtained this way. So this is a local statement from the open set in set of surfaces. So in other words, so what this means is, so we define open sets in the set of Abelian differentials on the surface with nodes. So the topological type is fixed, so you just go locally the surface on surface with nodes in this way, and you ask yourself, how can I come back to a Abelian differential on a surface without nodes? We open up, and so what you observe is a formula of the set. So in other words, there's an open neighborhood. So if you look at the surface with nodes in this way, there's an open neighborhood, say B, on the set of modelized space of Abelian differentials on the surface with nodes. The area is always one, so that means the sum of the areas is equal to one. And then there is a neighborhood V and this surface on the set of Abelian differentials on surface with nodes and a small disk of size epsilon. And this means that you somehow open up the nodes and this if you delete out V cross the original set, then this is open in the set of the Abelian differentials. So meaning that you can deform the Abelian differentials on your surface with nodes, you said that you get an entire beautiful, nice open set, and then you can make out an open set in the space of the Abelian differential on your regional surface. Of course then you have to delete the part that comes from the surface with the nodes. Alright, so why is this great? Because now we can define admissible configuration. On the flat on translation surface. This consists of a pair of homologous cellular connections. Not necessarily horizontal, but in the same direction. Parallel. And they are in this direction. There is no shoulder, no cellular connection. Lesser equal than or less of these. So what does it mean is I take my two homologous set of connection and I ask myself, how long are they?
And what I require that if I look at the direction, I'm a translation surface, so I can talk about directions. If I look at the direction, then I allow several connections, but they have to be longer than the one that I was looking at. So there's no shorter one. And why is this good? Because now we realize that this is actually an SR2R invariant set. That's very simple because we know exactly what the SR2R action does to translation surfaces. So it's an affine action. So it preserves directions, and it doesn't preserve lengths, but it preserves relative lengths if you fix the direction.
Sorry, so this is a SKM meso search.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Oh boy. How can it do this? You see the problem is it's
good to
write so many important papers and just
hang the Ursula. Don't worry.
I'm really ashamed. My apologies.
Never mind.
Next talk I ever give, I started talking in the same way. I talked about my.
Oh, yeah, first off, please. Do I have an eye to connect all?
Embarrassed. Okay, so we know that this is it's on. SR2R invariant. This set is SR2R invariant. And it's open. Because I showed you it's open, and since this, so SR2R invariant is easy, open comes from SKM meso search, so it's open SR2R invariant, and now of course, now Mariam's work with Alex Iskin kicks in. Because now we know what we expect. I mean, we have an open SR2R invariant set, so it's everything but something that has lower dimension. So this is by Iskin Mitakami. This is the fourth. Everything, so the complement. Positive. This corresponds to a family of closed orbit closures which are of smaller dimension. And why is this good? Because now we know that every surface with an admissible configuration, whether it be horizontal or not, it can be formed to a surface which in a real differential which lives on the surface with modes. And we can do induction. This means that each such surface can be performed with an absolute period in a leaf of F to the surface. With one set of law. So in other words, what this means is you can deform your flat surfaces to live in the leaves, to live on the surfaces mode. And now if we had the full information what's going on in the surface, all these surfaces nodes, then we are done. Then we could prove that the leaves are connected and everything else is good. And by induction. So assuming that everything is good on the surface with nodes, I can use this because the modelized, this particular modelized space of surface with nodes is just the two modelized spaces on the components. But there's one caveat. And the caveat is the area that the Abelian differential gives to both sides. And this is exactly where we have to be careful. If this weren't an issue, we would be done. But we are not done because of this area constraint. And now we have to be careful. And now, and try to find out how you can bypass this difficulty. And the way you can bypass it is by inducing on the smaller surface. Of course, I mean the surfaces have all genus at least 4, because in genus 3 and genus 2, you understand everything due to this principle that I alluded to before. And now what it boils down to is introducing more nodes and opening up the other node and being very careful with relative weights and areas. And then what you can prove is the theorem that I was alluding to about agudicity of the absolute period foliation, but let me finish with giving you at least one a new result in the Fourier's theorem, which says that one can have absolute period foliation. The stratum is one, at least one simple dual is at a. And again, you can deduce this by induction. You have to be much more careful how to degenerate, but again, it boils down to, and somehow it boils down to shows the proving connectedness of leaves as before. Once you have this, you are also in the first flood and you're done. And now, but you, again, I mean, the principle is you have to be careful about the weight. So if you say that you can degenerate always, simply because it's being, as something being able to degenerate is open and SL2 are invariant, so that's good. And now you can basically produce the same line of reasoning and prove this result that's by just being much, much, much more careful. Okay, so my last word is that, of course, so the Wigner's theorem at this point is not proven because now you want to put Wigner's to show orbit closures. But one consequence of this thing here, which is really nice, so a corollary of this thing is an affine invariant manifold. Invariant submanifold. In a stratum is a simple zero. Which is saturated for F. That means the dimension of the affine invariant manifold is twice the rank plus the dimension of the foliation. Here only exists if G is equal to 2. And that it does exist in G equal to 2, I showed you at the very beginning of my talk, because we have spoken of one of the surfaces that come from these irreducible lattices. All right, thank you very much.
Questions?
In your use of asking as a colleague, when you use it, you only want to be sure that you can perform this outside the measures. Is it important that these admissible foliations, non-admissible foliations, are out of co-dimension for the argument, or just measures of?
So you have to be careful when you use induction steps, so that's where it comes in. So it's nice to have it, and of course, so my particular point to mention is dimensional work, but also for the fact that if you want classification of measures for this foliation, measures for this foliation, right, then you will have to use Eskin-Mazzacani with the logic that those potential sort of measures that do not come, that are not GL SL2 are invariant because of this lattice property somehow. There are very few non-semi-simple lattices in SP2G plus SP2G minus 2R, which can be completely classified. And so the hope is that you may just ignore them at the first step and sort of use those that where you get automatically SL2R invariant, and then you can really use the orbit closures theorem and get going. So that's somehow the philosophy.
Other questions?
not, let's thank the speaker.